This is 1972's Hot Dogs for Gauguin. It's a student short film, and it stars a then-unknown Danny DeVito. He's a down-on-his-luck photographer who comes up with a get-rich-quick scheme and shares it with his best friend, who then tries to talk him out of it. Well, why do you ask? Well, the scheme involves an act of terrorism against the Statue of Liberty. And it was a comedy. The title can seem a bit misleading, as the film doesn't feature the work of artist Paul Gauguin or hot dogs. No, the title was named that because of how catchy it sounded. Think Paul Thomas Anderson's Licorice Pizza. In 2009, the film would be selected for preservation by the National Film Registry
and the Library of Congress,
which is pretty good considering how reactions typically are to student short films.
Student film? So nobody's gonna see this.
So you think the person that made this would be a pretty big name right now, right? Maybe a friend of Spielberg, maybe often quoted by film students or cinephiles? Well, the answer would be yes and no. This artist is actually one that's pretty close to my heart. And I've always wanted to give praise to a career that was cut short simply by just one mediocre film. This is the story of writer-director Martin Brest. Born August 8, 1951 in the Bronx, Martin, or Marty as his friends called him, says to have loved the television sitcom The Honeymooners as a young boy, citing its relatability to its less glamorous depiction of American life in the 1950s. In 1969, Brest graduated from high school and attended the NYU School of Arts, and from there attended the American Film Institute, where he directed his first independent feature, Hot Tomorrows, in 1977. The film featured a strong supporting cast, with a pre-Fantasy Island, Hervé Villechaize, the voice of fellow writer-director Orson Welles,
the Council predicts that over the Christmas season, 874 deaths will be caused by automobile accidents on the highways. Many of these people will die simply because they'll be stupid enough to get behind the wheel before sobering up from their holiday festivities.
Ah, the French champagne.
And future composer Danny Elfman as a club singer. The story focuses on an aspiring writer, played by Ken Lerner, on Christmas Eve in L.A. with his best friend, played by the late Ray Sharkey. The lead is obsessed with death and is writing a short story based on his flamboyant late aunt. But during the night's adventures, his best friend is suddenly killed in a car accident, twisting his morbid fascination with death into a personal nightmare. His concentration on death and mortality would be a theme in most of Brest's career.
I gotta spend another day doing nothing but sitting around in that park looking at the ugly kids, I'm gonna go nuts.
In 1979, on the success of Gauguin and Hot Tomorrows, Brest would enter Hollywood and direct three screen legends in a new adventure, Going in Style. Following three retired friends who decide to become bank robbers, figuring that at best they get away with it and can afford to make a living, and at worst they get arrested and live off the state in prison. Starring comedic legends George Burns along with Art Carney of the Honeymooners fame, and the legendary acting coach Lee Strasberg in his last film role. The film was Brest's first commercial outing and garnered positive reviews and proved he could direct the toughest genre in film, comedy.
Got an extra piece of gum? What do you say, Joe? I say, why don't you get the hell out of here? You give me a headache. Thanks for the gum.
Which would be his ticket to bigger things in the 1980s. But not without its bumps along the way.
Maybe you could tell us who first suggested the idea of reproduction without sex.
Your wife?
Brest was next hired to direct the film War Games, but ended up fired 12 days into filming, citing differences with the film's producer, who, being from early television, was used to more control, treating directors, as Brest referred to it, as bricklayers. After having put a year and a half into pre-production, he would be replaced with director John Badham. This led to a dark period in the director's life. Brest recalled a few times when the industry people saw him walking down the street, they would cross to the opposite side. That paired with the trade paper saying he was fired for being unable to make the film light enough. He would later say this taught him,
"When they say you're a bum, you're not a bum. When they say you're a hero, you're not a hero. It's all not to be paid attention to, the low and the high."
At this point, producer Jerry Bruckheimer and Don Simpson came calling about a new project they wanted to get off the ground. Beverly Hills Cop, starring the one and only Sylvester Stallone. The turmoil of life post-war games had made Brest hesitant and not feeling too up to the job.
Jerry Bruckheimer called me around every 20 minutes.
I just kept him on the phone for a couple hours and said, you're not getting off the phone until you agree to do this picture. And while he was talking to me, unbeknownst to me, Marty took out a quarter.
And I said, you know what? I'm going to flip this coin. And I swear to God, whatever it comes up, I will do.
The script was a run-of-the-mill police action flick. But Brest had decided he wanted to stand out and direct Stallone in a script that was more of a comedy, which the studio actually preferred, only for Stallone to break away from the project and make Cobra instead. And given his history with comedy, it was probably all for the best.
What are you doing here?
Mommy's got to change you.
Mommy, I don't want to be changed.
Now that the production was in need of a new leading man, they decided to look generally where people are considered not ready for prime time.
NBC Saturday night.
It's one hell of a day in my neighborhood. A hell of a day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be
mine? Eddie Murphy was no stranger to box office success at this point. He'd only been mostly cast in buddy films, opposite Dan Aykroyd in Trading Places, Nick Nolte in 48 Hours, and Dudley Moore in Best Defense. But the comedic actor would now get the opportunity to prove himself as a leading man. And the gamble would pay off.
And the kids were exploding with laughter, and they were just having the best time. And Eddie had a thrill sitting in the back of the theater watching the kids really enjoy it. I could see the big grin on his face.
And then there were lines around the block. For months, lines around the block. How could I have a bad day?
It was extremely gratifying to get that kind of audience response.
Beverly Hills Cop was considered the biggest hit of 1984, launching Martin and Murphy into the A-list. With the success, Brest had Hollywood asking how soon he could start the sequel.
Well, I felt like I did it already. I felt I sort of did it and I made it. You know, it was a very successful movie. And I felt at best I'd be going sideways in my career, and I feel, because I don't do movies that often, and that was only my second Hollywood movie, that I didn't want two-thirds of my total Hollywood output would have been at Beverly Hills Cop, and I didn't feel it was smart to do at that point in time.
That being said, he still held enough favor with the studios to produce his next script, Midnight Run. The story follows a bail bondsman pursuing an accountant who embezzled money from the mob and gave it to charity, trekking across the country in a matter of a week, while dodging the FBI who want the accountant as a witness for their own case, and another bail bondsman who wants the bounty for himself, and the mob who want their revenge. Or as Charles Grodin put it.
The story basically is a guy chases another guy, and then a third guy chases the two guys, and a whole lot of other people chase all of the guys.
The film would go on to get rave reviews. Following this, Brest would form his own production company and purchase the film rights to two features, the Italian 1974 film Profumo di Donna, and 1934's Death Takes a Holiday, and begin a new period for the director with a flavor closest to his pre-commercial days.
My skin, sir?
Oh, for Christ's sake.
I'm sorry, I don't...
Just call me Frank. Call me Mr. Slade. Call me Colonel, if you must. Just don't call me sir.
Having already worked with the Godfather himself, Brest would cast actor Al Pacino in Scent of a Woman. The film tells a story of a lower middle class prep school student played by Chris O'Donnell, who accepts a job over Thanksgiving weekend to care for a visually impaired former military man.
Hoo-ah!
Who has decided to go in style himself before ending his life.
What do you give a shit for?
About what?
About what? About whether I blow my brains out or not.
This period of Brest's career displayed most of what Playboy writer Matt Patches said Brest did best as an auteur.
He was a driven and idiosyncratic filmmaker, toiling over silly films deserving an ounce of sensitivity and serious films in need of not-so-serious touches.
And this is displayed amazingly by Pacino, whose often gruff and cruel demeanor often proves to be the comic relief to O'Donnell's youthful innocence trying to grasp the situation. Brest had done it again, but this time it led to an Academy Award nomination for Best Picture and Best Director.
The Oscar goes to Al Pacino in Scent of a Woman.
He's in the house, I can't pick him out, but I gotta thank him. I'm completely indebted to Marty Brest, who directed the picture.
But having gained the nomination, this would only back his talent further as he began his next adaptation of Death Takes a Holiday.
Who are you? Just think of millenniums multiplied by eons, compounded by time without end. I've been around that long. But it's only recently that your affairs here have piqued my interest.
In Meet Joe Black, we meet William Parrish, played by Anthony Hopkins. Bill, as his friends call him, is in the middle of selling his broadcasting company and retiring. Bill's daughter, played by Claire Forlani, is a doctor and engaged to one of the board members, Drew. But she admits to her father that the romance is almost born out of convenience and is the safe thing to do. Bill then urges her to take a chance because...
lightning could strike.
Later that day in the diner, Susan overhears a young lawyer played by Brad Pitt who is consoling his young sister over the phone, having just had her heart broken. Intrigued, Susan strikes up a conversation that continues into the street. Then just like that, later that night, Bill has a visitor.
Your death.
Yes.
You're not dead, you're just a kid in a suit.
The suit came with the body I took.
The runtime was 3 hours, the score was by Thomas Newman, and the storytelling was on point. Brest would craft a love story focusing on the bittersweet bonds of family, man's obsession with legacy, and knowing when to let go. The film would be met with mixed reviews, and the 90s would close on a more somber note. Martin would then pen his next film, a crime drama entitled Gigli.
In the case of Marty, he's a guy who really can say, he gives so much love and so much support, and he's been so kind to me, and we've sort of found ourselves on the same wavelength in terms of the things we think about and the sense of humor we have and the way we look at the world.
He was really, really, really open. He was really interested in what was going to make the best movie and what was going to bring out the best performances in us. And if we felt comfortable with something or uncomfortable, he was very open to whatever we felt.
Gigli was a mob film about a gangster hired to kidnap a federal prosecutor's mentally challenged brother with the help of a tough female enforcer. In 2001, pre-production would begin with the casting of Ben Affleck as the film's lead opposite pop artist Jennifer Lopez. But just as filming had started in 2002, what had also started was an arms race for the tabloids. The two cast members would become romantically involved, and it was all people would talk about. Columbia Pictures and Revolution Studios began trying to cash in on the press frenzy and rewrite the movie as a romantic comedy to give the public more of what they wanted. Suddenly, Martin found himself in a similar situation to War Games. Brest would later tell Rolling Stone magazine,
"Extensive reshooting and re-editing turned characters, scenes, story, and tone upside down in the futile attempt to make the increasing mess resemble a movie. In the end, I was left with two choices, quit or be complicit in the mangling of the movie. To my eternal regret, I didn't quit."
These are actual reviews that I culled because I, you know, pay attention to these things for the movie. So I'm going to read these and you'd let me know if you think it sounds like something you want to see. "Such an utter wreck of a movie. You expect to see it lying on its side somewhere in rural Pennsylvania with a small gang of engineers circling and a wisp of smoke rising from the caboose." That was a mistake.
Okay, for a moment, I want to play devil's advocate.
The devil's advocate.
No, seriously. Let's imagine you're an executive of a major film studio in the early 2000s.
God damn!
That's the spirit. Your task was something scary. You need to market an original script. Gross. Only now you're going viral, because the public's rooting for your two leads to get it on. For some reason. So you reassess the product. Okay, how can I turn a crime movie into a rom-com? Has it even been done before? And the answer is yes. In 1990, director Gary Marshall was given the script to Pretty Woman, only it was supposed to be a gritty look at prostitution in the 1980s. That's right, your mom's most treasured romance about America's favorite silver fox paying for sex with a 21-year-old was once considered a dark script. Disney had picked up the project and Marshall decided to lighten things up. The original title, $3,000, referencing how much Julia Roberts' character was being paid, gone. Julia Roberts' character being a drug addict, gone. The ending where Richard Gere dumps her out of his car and drives off after paying, gone. The scene where George Costanza does his Harvey Weinstein impression, Never mind, they kept that. Jesus Christ. With enough rewrites, the script was cobbled into one of cinema's most beloved rom-coms. So naturally, okay, let's do it again! Marshall would next find himself in a similar position while adapting the Anne Rice novel Exit to Eden, a novel focusing on a woman who runs a BDSM resort, falling in love with a client. Think 50 Shades of Grey, but, you know, competent. And Marshall gave them... the same story, but with a domineering, no pun intended, comedic subplot involving Dan Aykroyd and Rosie O'Donnell as bumbling undercover cops. And just like Gigli, it bombed, proving that if you have the ingredients for a pizza, don't try to make cake. Gary Marshall was a celebrated, competent director, so if this could happen to him, surely you can argue that Brest had the same odds. And I don't think the movie should be a stain on the director's abilities. I actually contemplated stopping the video at Gigli, because there's almost too much content out there about it. And to be frank, it's exhausting. People hear this man's name and think this.
It's turkey time.
Huh?
Gobble, gobble.
When they should really think about this.